Welcome all of you for another session on webinar. We almost done 20 sessions so far. It's been fantastic, and it's an initiative from Kottayam Nature Society and Alappuzha Naturalistic Society. And so today we are lucky to have Rajesh Puttamavasi. We've done a lot of studies. He's been documenting bats, and he runs an NGO also, Bat Conservation NGO, which he will be talking about it later. And let's hear from him. Thank you so much, Rajesh, for agreeing to give a talk, and over to you.
So hi everyone, good evening. I hope all of you are doing well and I've been safe now. It's quite an unprecedented time for all of us. I know it's a challenge, so it's quite interesting to see that a lot of people are taking initiatives to kind of organize these webinars. I think this is probably one of the best way how we can keep still in touch with wildlife and try and still keep our learning curve ahead. So I'll be giving a brief glimpse into what bats are, and then more on basic stuff. I wasn't too sure about the kind of audience that we have who will be joining here. So try to keep it as basic as possible with few interesting aspects of bats and their ecology. Hope it really helps you kind of understand more about bats and start appreciating them. I know the community here probably are wildlife lovers, so would definitely be more pro to bats than the general public that we've been seeing who are going kind of in rampage mode right now. I'll start with few basics, then kind of take you through some of the conservation challenges at the end of the session. But if you have any questions, please post it. I mean, if there are too many, I think David will probably open up at the later end of the session, and then we can definitely answer. So I really want to make this more interactive session. So I would probably spend less time in explaining or showing you certain aspects of it, and then spend more time in Q&A. So I hope that works well. So I'll be closing my video so that we can use the bandwidth for the photographs. Okay. So first and foremost, I think one, what does come to mind when we talk about, when you think about bats, right? So for most of us, especially in mainland, I think the one of the common thing that kind of when we, what we visualize about bats is usually the Indian flying fox. So for a lot of common people, bats means only the flying fox. So a lot of them don't know about anything else other than the flying fox. If not about flying fox, I think the only other thing that probably clicks someone's mind at this point of time is virus. I mean, everyone is worried about coronavirus, or earlier it was Nipah or some other virus. But for some of us who are in the urban environment, probably would have seen, other than the flying fox, probably the short-nosed foot bat is something that's been commonly seen, which is most urban environment in your traffic life, we would have probably observed in your nearby homes, we would have seen them fly through. So this is one of the most common bat which is adapted well enough to the urban environment. And is this all about bats, or is there more? We do have a lot more about diversity, which I want to talk about. But now I think one of the core points that I want to first and foremost address is, which probably is in everybody's mind right now, is do bats really carry viruses, and do they really impact human beings? Yes, bats do carry viruses. They are the reservoirs of a lot of zoonotic viruses, but does not mean that bats are the only mammals or animals that carry zoonotic. For example, there's a recent publication that was published by a team of researchers, part of National Academy of Sciences, who went through tons of research papers to kind of identify what species are carrying what type of viruses, what is the rationale, what is the ratio in terms of the rural population size versus the number of viruses that they carry, and in what scenarios or with what kind of viruses are really affecting human beings? Are they really transmitting to the human beings? So if you look at this report, probably this pictorial representation here shows the number of viruses that the bat species carry versus what a rodent species would carry, or a primate, or galleriforms, which is basically the birds and stuff, or the, or domestic animals would carry. So if you really compare that way, I think the number of species of virus that the bats carry and which transmits to human beings is very less. Unfortunately, bats have been the villains of the animal kingdom, I would say, when it comes to zoonotic viruses. Sadly, everyone, the moment you talk about any zoonotic viruses, it's always the bats that are being recognized or identified with, which is really not true. There are cases where, of course, bats do impact human beings, for example, Nipah virus or Ebola virus, but such cases are very less compared to other viruses that probably transmit to human. And again, these viruses don't transmit directly to human beings. They need a secondary host. So the virus that bats carry may not necessarily be able to kind of transmit without any intervention of a secondary host, either like a could be a bird, or it could be a pig, or a poultry, or any other secondary host. So blaming bats per se for all the pandemics is definitely not the right approach. Again, before June, the coronavirus, we always used to hear about bats carrying rabies and how many, how does it impact human beings and stuff. Fortunately, at least I have not come across in my experience so far, not even a single bat-based rabies that's affecting human beings. So there are rabies virus, seven different types of rabies virus. It could be from horse, it could be from dogs, it could be from fox or jackal. But human beings affecting or getting affected with these rabies are highly remote. And bat rabies, at least there's not been even a single case reported from India so far. Similarly, there are other viruses which bats host. Again, as I said, they always need a secondary host. Probably this picture would clearly explain to you what are the secondary hosts that has impacted in the past and how it has transmitted to human beings. So either through civet or through pig or through camel. I think MERS was through camel, which happened in Middle East some time back. Nipah, obviously, which happened in Kerala sometime in 2 years back, and then in Bangladesh and some parts of West Bengal and Malaysia. And of course, Ebola, which had an impact in the West African region. So other than this, there hasn't been any other incidence of any zoonotic viruses transmitting to bats. Obviously, there are a lot of research going on now to kind of identify where would be the future emerging diseases and what needs to be done. As of now, even in the coronavirus, there are a lot of theories which says that coronavirus transmitted through bats from China. And there are different school of thought which says it was probably modified before it was spread or accidentally got spread to human beings. So, however, there is no concrete evidence as such for any of these theories. So it's too early or premature, I would say, for any of us to kind of tag bats as the root cause for the coronavirus or any other zoonotic virus unless we have evidence for it. So I think first we should probably stop blaming and villainizing bats as a repository for the viruses and spread. I think one of the challenges that we all have, especially the common man, is that they all hear only about the negative role of bat or what has happened to the human beings through virus and stuff. Unfortunately, most of them don't realize what is the role of a bat in the ecosystem. How do they help human beings or our economy broadly, and what role did they play? So in fact, I've been studying about wildlife almost last 25 years, and then specifically focusing on bats for the last 10 years. When I interact with my fellow naturalists in the wildlife domain, most of them even don't know. I mean, they might know about most of the mammals or birds, but most of them may not know enough about bats. It's very surprising that people don't know about bats. That's probably one of the reasons why they're always marred with myths rather than revered as one of the best mammalian species. Just to kind of summarize or highlight, there are three key aspects that bats offer. Of course, there are a whole lot of other stuff. But if you talk about three core benefits that bats offer, I think one and first and foremost would be the seed dispersal. Bats are one of the best seed dispersal that happens in the forest. Just like what birch, other birch, or even hornbills, like hornbills are classified as the farmers of the forest. So what hornbills do in the daytime, bats do in the nighttime. That's one of the key difference here, or I would say the comparison. So bats end up spreading the seeds across the forest and helping regeneration of the forest, rainforest, or even the normal forest. Similarly, bats also one of the key pollinators. So there are a lot of commercial crops which are considered to be pollinated by bats. For example, bats do help in pollination of the commercial crop like banana, agave, especially in Mexico and Latin America region, which is through which the tequila is made. And then bats are also known to pollinate durian fruit, which is a very well-known and very commercial crop in the Southeast Asian region. And they do help in increasing the yield. So obviously, bats are definitely one of the best friends of the farmers, I would say, which help in increasing the yield. Similarly, the insectivorous bats, primarily which feed on insects, are one of the considered to be the best pest controls. So each bat has a set of prey base that they depend on, and each of these bats help in consuming those prey base, which is different insects, and help in different types of pest control. So I'll give you a little bit more example. For example, in fact, the Indian plantation management clearly says, as part of their horticultural methodology, for example, the bats like horseshoe bats or the leaf nose bats are considered as one of the natural pest control. So when you talk about agriculture or the horticulture aspect, there are different types of pest control management. One could be the organic way, and then pesticides, and also it's called as ecological engineering. So in the ecological engineering perspective, bats and birds are classified as one of the natural pests, and including spiders are considered as one of the natural predators basically to control these pests. So it's very positive, I would say, to know that even some of our own Indian agricultural department have started recognizing bats as one of the best predators for pest control. So I think where we're probably losing is we, some of us who are working on bats, probably have not recognized this and start spreading information to the common man. So I think that's something that probably all of us should start spreading, and then make people understand what is the value that these bats really bring into the ecosystem. So what are the bats? I mean, how many types of bats do we have? I'm sure probably many of us would be surprising to know that there's a huge diversity of bats in India. We have about 400 plus species of mammals in India, and bats account to almost about 25 to 28% of those mammalian species, not just in India, but across the world. In India, we have about 128 species, which are now listed by ZSI as a total number of species of bats, out of which 14 of them are about fruit bats, and remaining 100 plus, 110 plus are insectivorous bats. So of these 14 fruit bats, about 7 to 8 of them are found in mainland India. The remaining of them are primarily found in the Andaman Nicobar Islands, so more endemic to Andaman Nicobar Islands. So I think most commonly found bats, I would say here, would be in the Indian flying fox, the short-nosed fruit bat, and the fulvous fruit bat, what we call as resistant resistivity. The Indian flying fox and the short-nosed fruit bats are primary tree roosters, which you can probably find in daytime, whereas the fulvous fruit bat is primarily a cave rooster, or which is found in abandoned ruins or temples, or old stone temples in the South Indian temples, or the ruins, basically. Whereas the cave nectar bat is again more of a cave dwelling species and found in maybe the man-made tunnels. So Salimaris fruit bat is something very rare, found only in a couple of national parks in South, in Tamil Nadu and Kerala right now, especially I think KMTR area. So when it comes to insectivorous bats, we have quite a huge diversity. Here I've just shown you a couple of leaf nose bats and horseshoe bats, and we have something called free-tailed bats and tomb bats and pipistrelles. So these insectivorous bats offer great benefit in terms of pest control. For example, pipistrelles are considered to be one of the best pest control when it comes to mosquitoes. So you find pipistrelles in most urban environment. They're found across whether it's village or urban environment. You find them in the evenings, easy to notice. All you need to do is just when you step out in the evening before the dusk, just look out for the sky, and then you might see this bat flying, fluttering in the air, which probably you could mistake them for a butterfly, but they're actually bats which have a haphazard flight. So they are known to consume almost 1,000 mosquitoes in an hour. So as long as we have these pipistrelles in our neighborhood, I think they are one of the best control who can probably prevent diseases like malaria, dengue, Zika, and other mosquito-borne diseases. In terms of habitats, you find bats in various habitats. I mean, they're quite widespread. They're one of the most adaptable mammalian species, I would say. Some of the common habitats is the tree where you find this Indian flying fox, which is open, probably the only bat that's kind of grows openly, which is visible to us. The other could be the case, the largest roost, I would say, which probably houses a multitude of bats would be a large cage, which can host even millions of bats in one roost and host multiple species together. Not necessarily single species, but also multi-species. So some of the cases that I've seen host almost 5 to 7 species of bats in the same cave. And each of them would have different niche in that particular cave, which we'll talk about. Then we have, especially in the south, we have a lot of cave temples which are protected by the cultural aspect. Fortunately, there's no harm made to these bats, and they still manage to kind of thrive with all the tourism that happens locally in that cave environment. Similarly, we have tree holes. So dead trees are very important. Lot of bats roost in the tree holes. Either on the tree bark, between the gaps of the bark, or even other small tree holes. Similarly, we have old temples, especially in South India. If you go to any temple in Tamil Nadu or Karnataka or Andhra, you find a lot of these tomb bats, the free-tailed bats, roosting in those temples. Similarly, monuments. So this was photographed, I think, in Delhi, where the monument was renovated with a fresh set of paint, and the bats still came back. So they are very adaptable, and you just give them sufficient space and place for them to kind of come back. They definitely can kind of come back, and even if you chase them out, so they can really come back and make themselves comfortable back into the roost. Similarly, we have old ruins. All the old forts and ruins that you can find, you would probably all unused places would have been occupied by bats. This was photographed in Golconda. And old homes. So all wooden homes, especially the rural sites, you'd find bats taking up common place either in the storeroom or probably where people would store their eels or like say coconut storage yards. Bats can be found there. So people have been living with these bats in harmony. A lot of rural folks really are not bothered about bats. Sadly, it's the negative media representation that kind of creates a woke and then creates negative perception in people. For example, I photographed this bat in a place near Kumta where there's a 110-year-old house and the family lived with these bats in a small 4x4 room. So they had set aside this small 4x4 room only for these bats, and we had about 250 bats living in that house. And when I inquired about people being bothered, the housemates said they've been living with them for ages and they're not really worried about, and they never were bothered about any virus or other stuff. So people are really living in harmony with bats. I think it's important that we tell these stories to the broader folks so that the people understand. As I mentioned earlier, I think one of the core role with bats is as a seed dispersal and as a pest control. Sorry, I think I already talked about this. Lot of bats have a very diverse prey base. And again, this depends from season to season. For example, this is a gonu photograph of gonu pay lesser false form per bat, what we call Megadermo spasma. You can see the diversity of the prey base here. You have the wings of a praying mantis, you have the arm of the praying mantis, then the beetle shell, there's a feather of a small bird, and sorry, I think this image is not showing. There is butterflies and moths, cicadas. So quite diverse, depending on season, these bats can change their priority with respect to their dietary requirement. And they're one of the best control. For example, there are certain kind of beetles, heart-shaped beetles, which are primarily preyed by bats like Hippostris lankadiva, which has the strongest jaws. So these bats help in pest control. For example, the horseshoe and the leaf-nose bat, which feed primarily on the floor of the forest, primarily feed on smaller insects like moths, centipedes, and caterpillar stuff. Some of the larger bats like this Megadermo can even feed on small birds and mammals. For example, this rodent was devoured by the greater false form of bat in one of the cave where I photographed it. So not only insects, bats can also be one of the best controlled when it comes to rodents. So whether it's paddy field or any other agricultural field, bats can really help a farmer in terms of protecting their crops. So that's one of the core role that the bats play in the ecosystem. And in terms of identification, so unlike birds, so I'm sure most people would be here from the birding background and probably would be used to identifying birds with their key features of birds, whether it's the beak or the coloration of the beak, the feathers. But bats aren't that easy to identify in the natural environment. First of all, because they're nocturnal in nature, you will not be able to identify all their identification keys through naked eye. You would probably require a good binocular or a night scope. With the proper lighting requirement, and the moment you use any light or lighting system, they do get disturbed. So it's quite challenging to kind of observe and identify bats. However, if you have can manage to get a good photograph, it is possible to identify bats through photograph. While a lot of biologists, the cryptologists might disagree with that point. I've experienced myself by photographing bats for a couple of years now that if we can get good photograph of different perspectives, then it's quite easy to kind of identify these bats. So there are certain keys that each species or each family has. And if you look at these identification keys or perspectives, then it's quite easy. For example, in this image, you can see the two different bats here of belong to the same family, which is a leaf-nosed bat, so Hippostris family. One on the left-hand side, to me, is a Cantus leaf-nosed bat, and the other is Snyder's leaf-nosed bat. There's not much difference here. The subtle difference is the supplementary leaflets found in these two bats. So whereas the Cantus leaf-nosed bat has only two supplementary leaflets, whereas the Snyder's leaf-nosed bat has three supplementary leaflets. So within the Hippostris family, we have multiple species of bats. Each of them have different characters. Some of them have single supplementary leaflets, some of them have four, some of them don't have even a single one. While supplementary leaflets are one of the identification key, but that alone is not the limitation. So we also look at the metacarpal bones. Sorry, I'm not marked here, but the length of the metacarpal bones, basically the fingers, the length of the fingers, also help in determination of the species in bats, unlike in birds. So that's another aspect that we look at. Again, there are a few other aspects, the identification key that we look from different species perspective. Another example that I have here is the false vampire bats, the greater false vampire or the lesser false vampire. If you look at the greater false vampire bat, which is much gray in color on top, and you have the cella, what we call as a nose leaf structure. It's much more longer, it's lengthy. Nose leaf structure, which is kind of concave shape. And also the base of the nose leaf has a much more heart-shaped structure than a triangular shaped structure. So some of these characters help in identification of species. So sadly, there's not many literature as well. There's not many books which can highlight these aspects for us to kind of identify. Hopefully we will have one soon in the coming years. I know a couple of my friends are also working on revised material on this, but I think we should be able to see some new material coming next few years. Similarly, we have tomb bats. Again, there are different ways we can identify tomb bats. For example, there's something called black bear tomb bat, where you can prominently see a black beard under the throat. So we can, through that, we can identify the species. So I'll not dwell too much into that. Other aspect we look at in terms of identification is, while the visual cues sometimes could be challenging even with a photograph, you know, insectivorous bats use echolocation as one of the navigation methodology. So there are recorders which help us to record these calls, especially the echolocation calls when they're traversing. And these echolocation calls have different frequencies. So bats use a frequency which is between 20 kilohertz or sometimes even less, 10 to 15 kilohertz up to 220 kilohertz frequency, which is not audible to human ears. So we need special devices called ultrasound recorders. There are multiple ultrasound recorders. I'm just using a few images here, which is from a company called Wildlife Acoustics. So these devices help us in recording the ultrasound of the emitted by the bat, and then we play back those calls. And each of these calls have a different signature pattern because each species uses a certain frequency to communicate. And with these frequencies, and again, there's a length, depending on the length of the call and depending on the frequency range and what we call as modulation, either constant frequency modulation or frequency modulation, the call looks different. When you put on a software, the sonograms differ. So this image gives you an idea how the calls look like, not how we hear, because we can still hear the calls. When it playbacks at 10x, when it's multiplied by 10 times faster, we can still hear the calls. But when you put the same call on a sonogram, you can see the signature of each species and at respective length and the frequency. So this diagram will show you the frequency and the bandwidth of the call, at what frequency they call and what is the bandwidth that each of the call have. For example, the first five calls here are all belonging to hippocentaurus. So there is, if you look at the signature, they all look like seven, right? So they all look very similar, but there is subtle variation in the, either in the bandwidth or in the constant frequency. So, and also in the overall frequency range. So that really helps us in understanding as what bat it exactly it was, while we may not have be able to get a visual cue. Similarly, when you look at horseshoe bats, the Rhilophus species, you have a steady constant frequency, then you have ups and downs. So basically it kind of varies, and depending on the flight and when it probably identifies a prey, there is a slight change in the frequency range. So we use these devices basically to record bat calls and then analyze them. Database for which they can rely on. Unfortunately, in India, we don't have a database which we can rely on as a call library. So once we have a call library, then any person who wants to kind of probably identify this bat should be able to record a bat call and then compare with the software and then analyze, okay, this particular bat was so-and-so. But right now, unfortunately, in India, none of the bat researchers or any other organization has developed a call library for all the 100 plus species. I think collectively we might all have about 50 species right now, but we don't still don't have a common repository. I'll just take a pause. David, you want to pop up any questions so far, or should we continue?
If you want, you can take the questions. Do you want to do it like that?
Yeah, I think I'll probably just take a break and take a few questions.
Okay. I'm sure I just opened the chat box. If you guys have any questions, you can come in.
Has anyone posted in questions?
So far, no.
Okay. Then in that case, maybe we can move ahead.
No, there is a question from Shyam Gathir. Is it safe to handle bats with a bare hand? How would they transmit virus to secondary host? I think he sent it to me. It should have been.
Okay, no worries. Yeah. So obviously, it's not safe to handle any wild animal, not just bats, with bare hands, because not just viruses, they all carry whatever the pathogens and other bacteria. So you should always save to use a gloves before handling any wild animal. And once you handle the wild animal, obviously you need to whatever sanitize your hand, wash your hands thoroughly, and then ensure there's no fluids or any either the bat excreta or the wild animal excreta or urine touches your leaf of body, and then there's a cut or a wound in your body. So you should always put sufficient protective gear before you handle any wild animal. Yes, if the just like any other mammals, bats also carry rabies virus or zoonotic viruses. Unless you're bitten or there is a clear-cut transmission of any of the body fluids or the saliva, then I don't think it needs to be worried. It's always safe to kind of sterilize and clean your hand and then your body area where you probably touch the bat and handle it. Yeah. I hope that answers your question. Any more?
You can take the question you have already presented. Rest of the normal question, you can probably come to the final session.
Okay, sure. Yeah, so I'll just want to, we did cover quite a lot of generic aspects now. So I just want to kind of highlight a few interesting perspectives about bats. And probably then we can take on the questions at the end of the session. So, you know, bats basically roost in trees, right? So we have this special bat, which is quite common in urban environment, called short-nosed foot bats. This is a bat which has noticed that it kind of creates its own space. It kind of creates a tent. So I call it as a tent-making bat. Again, this depends from roost type to roost type. For example, the one you guys see here is a fruit bunch of a tree called fish-tail palm tree. It's called Carota erans in a Latin name. And what this bat does is when this fruiting prod is emerging, so it nibbles the center fruit bunches so that it kind of creates an open space in the center. And all the other fruit which is kind of hanging on the sides reduces the light getting emitted and then manages the wind temperature or air temperature inside. So it creates a small open space and then there's an opening at the bottom. So the bat basically enters through that. So if you notice, all these red marks are created here, it shows where it's kind of chewed off the central part. Basically, the bats enter through the side or through the bottom, sneaks in, then start chewing off one by one, and then create the space in between. For example, you see here, it's been chewed off fruit. So it creates a space to create a tent-like structure. And if, again, depends on, different type of places. Again, here you see a harem. And these bats roost in a small group. They, unlike the cave-dwelling bats, they don't roost in huge numbers or the Indian flying fox. Usually, the short-nosed foot bats has a small colony of about 8 to 10 or maximum 15 bats together, huddled together. So this is probably a small harem with one male and multiple females together, and then probably the previous year, young ones, the pups, sub-adult here. So not all bats roost in huge colonies. So there are some bats which are solitary in nature and some bats probably have a smaller colony. So this short-nosed foot bat uses this fish-tail palm tree fruit pod, which probably lasts almost about 5-6 months from the time it kind of emerges out by the time the fruits are ripe and then the leaves. For example, if you look at this image here, you see the fruits are already ripe here. So by the time the fruits start growing to the time the fruits ripe and then fall down, it's almost about 4 to 5 months. So the bats have one standard place for them to roost. And what these bats do is they go to the nearby fruiting tree, collect the fruit, come back to this roost and eat in the roost. Or they go to some other temporary roost and then have the eat the fruit from their temporary roost and then leave. So not just this palm, but any other palm leaves. For example, we have multiple palms which are used in gardens. The ideal way is not to remove those dry leaves, because those dry leaves acts as a place for this bat to create their own tank and then grows there. So, and again, if wherever there's no such tree available, we are seeing this bat accommodate in a human dwelling environment. For example, in a lot of urban environment, you would find these bats roosting under the window ovens. So if you have a tiled chajja to your window, has a dark space and then has ambient temperature, this bat would be the first one to kind of find that place and roost there. So very unique and very specialized behavior, I would say. There are a few other behaviors which I'll just give you some snippets just so that you guys can understand better about their ecology and their interesting perspectives. Because again, a lot of these behaviors are not much studied. So we have a lot of people in India focusing more on identification or distribution. But in terms of behavior, not much has been studied. I think probably the only university who's done enough work in terms of behavioral ecology of bats is Madurai Kamaraj University. But I don't know whether they would have enough focus down the line, because most of the veterans have all moved out into the new life now. So for example, here the bat you see is called as lesser mouse-tailed bat. What exactly it is doing is a male. The one on the top is open wing, is a male, and the other one is a female, which is blood odd. So I observed this bat flapping its wing and then kind of trying to kind of corner and then control this female, not moving from the other place, and was not letting another male. So basically it was kind of courtship behavior, trying to kind of attract and control the female. So bats do have different behavior when it comes to mating. And again, this differs from species to species. For example, the Rosettus lecherae, the fulvous fruit bat, is known to be kind of polyandrous. So again, different species have different behavior. Another aspect here is that roost demarcation. So if you look at this image, there are two species of bats here. The one on the bottom side you see is a Snyder's leaf-nosed bat. That's a Hipposus purus. The one on the top is a lesser mouse-tailed bat. So I found these two species roosting in the same cave, and this is probably documented almost about 20 years back, and had not really known the difference at that point of time. I'd never seen, even after multiple visits, I've never seen these two species mixing together, being on either same side, both of them being on the same side. They always have their own area demarcated and not let other bats take the space. So what this means is some of these bat species are quite territorial in nature. They protect their own places and they will not let others take over. But that is not a standard behavior for all bats. We can't say that this is comfort. There are huge differences with other bats as well. This is another example where this is a Rosettus lecherae, the fulvous fruit bat, which was roosting in a temple in Madurai. And these are also territorial within the same species. They try and create their own area. All the yellow marking you see on the roof of the wall here are all urine marks. So they basically spray the urine or lap up the urine there and kind of create their own space and not let other bats take over. Of course, if there's a huge difference, disturbances and the stuff, they do manage for a time being, but predominantly they want to stick to their own roost places and not let others be taken over. Whereas in this image you see two different species. One is a Rhinolophus lepidus, other one I'm not sure yet, I've not been able to identify it 100%. There are two different species of bats which are kind of huddled together here. Basically, they do this for the warmth and the safety when they're in huge numbers. So there are certain places where different species of bats kind of cohabit together. Not only cohabit in the same cave, but also kind of gel together and then warm up together with each other. So this is another place. So this again to kind of create a sufficient heat and then retain that body heat there to keep themselves warm. So all these bats huddle up here together. So a lot of case when you see, especially when it starts getting chilled in the winter season, you find these bats kind of huddle up together and then stay together rather than staying individually and then trying to kind of create their own territory. So here they do stay together in a common place. Planting. So fruit bats, of course, do plant when there's when there's high temperature outside and huge humidity, and obviously just like any other dog or jackal stuff, where to kind of regulate their body temperature, they do plant. So this is a process necessary during heat, summer temperatures. They were seen and observed to be planting for a while in the afternoon. So just like any other mammal, most bats are born without their eye open. Their eyes open after some time, and normally with the position, they always stick to the mother. So the moment they give birth, so they it's kind of instinctively, just like how it happens in primates. The young ones by default are instinctively cling on to the mother and then stay with the mother. So if you look here, the pup is facing upwards. The head is facing the upwards, not towards the mother's face. And then usually the mammary glands are close to the the neck and the upper body, right? So the bats will turn around when they want to kind of suckle, but when they are resting position, they kind of turn back, and then it's much easier for them to kind of cling on. So. And again, when they're flying, the pups stay back with the mother and stick to the body. But as a pup grows, when it kind of gains weight, that's the time when the pups are left back in the cave. And then there's a separate maternal colony where pups, again, this differs from species to species. Some bats leave the pups back, even when they're young, back in the cave, go out for feed and then come back and then feed the young ones. But a couple of species carry the young ones with them all the while when they're foraging in the forest, and then keep feeding the young ones continuously. Probably you would have noticed the Indian flying fox, the pups are not left back in the tree, they're always with the mother. Whereas some of the insectivorous bats leave the pup back in the cave in the first few days and then carry them back until they gain weight. Once they gain weight, then they're usually kind of separated and fed back. So you'd all seen with the birds kind of chicks when they're ready to fly out, they practice the flight in the nest itself, right? Where they trying to kind of hover around the on top of the nest and then stretch their wings, trying to keep beating the wing and then keep fluttering and then start practicing the flight. So even bats pup do the same. So they keep clinging to the mother and then keep flapping and trying out the aerodynamics of the wing and how to fly and all. So bats are also known. So they start practicing with the by clinging onto the mother and then take short flights and then kind of come back and stay with the mother. So it's quite similar flight training pattern that we have seen in bats as well. So conservation challenges. I think one of the biggest conservation challenge we have for bats is the destruction of habitat. One thing which I noticed is a lot of cave dwelling species of bats are hugely impacted. The reason being, even the policy makers don't recognize some of these habitats as important to them. They only look at whenever they approach for permission, they basically look at whether that habitat has large mammals or key species found in that area or not. However, bats have always been ignored. I don't think there's been any evidence where bats were regularly recognized and the area was protected, other than two examples which has happened in Karnataka. But nowhere, I think, in India, we have seen in a case where any policymaker would have looked for bats before they kind of given permission. So this image was shot closer to Bangalore, where this huge quarry was going on, this hillock. And we had documented about four species of bats in this small hillock. Bat Conservation Trust has a project where we kind of manage monitor these cave roosts regularly. We missed out going to the same cave for almost about 6 to 8 months. And when we went for the subsequent time, we really lost, we had lost the half of the hillock. So the bats were really gone. There is no more hill in this place. Then hunting is our second biggest challenge. While there's mass hunting happens in certain states, I think we have records in Nagaland, Kerala, and Arunachal Pradesh. but there's regular hunting for medicine purpose that happens across India. There's a pursued thought that bats are medicinally good for a couple of diseases like stroke and anemic body nature. But that's far from truth is what we understand. Yeah, this is again hunting. Renovation of old temples and monuments have been one of the biggest threats. We have seen government spending crores together to renovate temples in the south, where the bats are chased out, others spoked out or burnt, and chemicals being used to kill them. And similarly, in the north and other parts of India, where there are a lot of ruins which host bats, are being chased out or being killed. So it's sad reality that we spent close together or billions of rupees to maintain our historical heritage site, but not our natural heritage. So I think it's important that we recognize bats as one of the natural heritage and then kind of protect their habitat rather than protecting the monuments. Other biggest challenge, I'll just take another 2-3 minutes, probably then we can take questions. One of the biggest challenge for any of us to study bats is the lack of literature or availability of books. The only book that has sufficient information about bats in India is the Bats of Indian Subcontinent, published by Dr. Paul Bates and David Harrison. Again, this is a very old book, which probably does not depict a lot of distribution of various species. And the recent book is by Vivek Menon, The Indian Mammals. Again, a lot of input on Vivek's book originated from various new papers plus Bats of Indian Subcontinent. However, the information available in any of these books are not really adequate enough. So I think there is a need to carry out more research and publication of more information is required. The reason why I say that is very important is in the last couple of years, we've seen new discoveries that's happening with bats. There's a couple of species being discovered in Northeast India. And I know for the fact within our bat community that there are a couple of species which are still cryptic and not really been documented, or there's not any evidence to prove whether the follow a certain species or a subspecies or a certain should be classified as a separate species. So there's still work going on. I think it's a very exciting time and for someone to kind of study bats. Similarly, we have a lot of new distribution mapping. So all the literature that talked about certain bat species to be found only in the Western Ghats, we have enough evidence of those bats to be found in the drier area of in the central India or even the Deccan Plateau or even in the Eastern Ghats. So there's quite a lot of information that needs to be unearthed and then studied about bats. So one of the biggest challenge that we face with respect to bats is that bats don't have recognition in our legal system. So other than the two species which have been accorded protection under Schedule 1, none of the other species have got any protection. In fact, all the fruit bats, all the 14 fruit bats, including the endemic ones found in Andaman and Nicobar Islands, are classified as vermin in Schedule 5, which means anyone can really hunt these bats and will not be put for any offense. So, simple example, the issue that we've been facing in the last 2 weeks across India, where people are really killing bats and then kind of chopping down a tree, if the forest department wants to really take an action, probably it would not really stand ground in the court of law, because the bats that primarily they've been killing would be the fruit bats and they classified as vermin. Of course, there's still ways that could be one person could be booked because book more the chopping of tree, but rather not on the killing the bat, because bats are classified as vermin and it's very difficult to protect or defend in the court of law. The only two species that is Rotten's free-tailed bat. Fortunately, the government recognized there is a dedicated wildlife sanctuary declared for Rotten's free-tailed bat, which is called Bhimgad Wildlife Sanctuary, which is in northwest Karnataka. And we have Salimalis fruit bat, which was discovered, I think, in Meghamalai Hills or KMTR a couple of years back, and that one has been given protection so far. So we still have a couple of species of bats which are either classified as critically endangered or endangered or vulnerable, but so far no production has been given. For example, the coalar leaf nose bat, which hardly numbers in about 150 to 200 in individuals now, and found only in one last cave, is facing extinction because there's no production to it from a legal perspective. Of course, the Karnataka Forest Department recently declared Hanumanhalli, which is the roost of the bat, as a conservation reserve. And there have been researchers like Dr. Srinivas Law and PMO who have done extensive work to kind of get to this level where the particular roost was protected by the Forest Department, Karnataka Forest Department. But I think there's still a lot more that needs to be done by us to identify more bat species, more roost locations which needs protection. So this is the image of the Rotten's fatal bat. So for those of you who have not seen, this is one of the most colorful or velvety, good looking. Of course, the face may not look as good looking as other bats, but I think it's really a very interesting species. One of the very fast flying bat, and it uses very low frequencies, somewhere around 12 to 18 kilohertz. This is basically a high canopy feeder, which feeds on moths and insects above the canopy level in a forest. So very interesting bat, found only in one cave in southern India. That's in Barapada cave in the Western Ghats. There is one more report of this bat found in Meghalaya, in Jaintia Hills. And the third report is in Cambodia. So there's only three known location of this bat. And this bat is classified as data deficient in as per IUCN standards. So, which means there's not much information available for this bat to even be classified appropriately. So it's very important that we kind of do extensive study to understand more about these bats. Why exactly are they found in three different locations, which has a gap of almost about 3,000 kilometers between each roost location? So that's an interesting perspective. Do they migrate? We don't know. Similarly, Selimulus foot bat, this is probably another interesting bat which I had an opportunity to kind of study for a short period of time. Was found in a cave which had a waterfall running beneath. So well, it's very interesting to know its preference of habitat, where probably it prefers more moist environment than a dry environment. Okay, so this is my last slide. Basically, how can one contribute or how can one take up bat? So I think the simple suggestion is start observing bats. I mean, you don't need to go too far. You don't need to go to forest area. All you do is just step out in the evening, look out for the sky, watch the bat flying in the air, try and understand their movement, enjoy the movement, the ad hoc flight that they are doing, and trying to catch insects in the air. Then you can probably observe the short-nosed foot bat, which is very commonly available in most of the environment. You look for any Singapore cherry tree or a fig tree or even any ficus tree, you would probably see these bats around them. So you can probably learn a lot about their movement, what time they emerge, what time they feed, what time they kind of slow down, and watch what are the kind of fruits that they feed on. So there's a lot that you can probably study. If you want to participate in a bigger aspects of it, want to learn, want to handle bats, then want to be part of a bigger project, obviously you can work back with any of the researchers in India as well as the Bat Conservation Trust. We have a couple of projects running. So two of the main key projects is more about identification of roost locations and mapping those roost locations so that we can monitor their ecology over a period of time and ensure there's adequate protection to these. So we keep visiting various new locations. We keep investigating and searching for new roost locations across India and try and map them into our database so that the same can be monitored by regional teams. So obviously, I know a lot of you participants are from across India. It will be great to us to know that if you guys can start working, carrying out bat-related work in your own area, probably we can map much larger area and then try and identify more species and understand their distribution map. So Bat Conservator would be happy to provide any technical guidance and training required to carry out those work. In fact, we're already partnering with a couple of other regional NGOs working on various other aspects of it to kind of increase the capacity building. If you're working full time and you want to join only in the weekend or free when you're free, you're happy to drop a note to us, and then we'll be happy to facilitate you to kind of join any of the field projects that we have. We have also a couple of other projects running, basically about digitization, creating of a bad call library and photo documentation. Probably would have realized by now, there are many species of bats in India which have not even been photographed. We don't even know how they really look like. And whatever most of the photos are probably would still see could be like handled and not really a natural setup. So we need these bats also to be photographed and documented so that we can show the world that these are amazing animals and needs to be protected. And obviously, we need financial support to carry out a lot of work. Some of these are quite expensive, attracts a lot of administrative costs as well. And also for people working, carrying out any of our interns and student working, they need to be compensated for stipend. So we are, so far we've been self-funded. We've not gone for public funding, but this year 2020, we had planned to go for CSR and attract public funding, but thanks to the pandemic, we don't know how far we'll be successful with that. But nevertheless, we'll still try our best and then probably look at how to take up bigger projects, do much more what we have been doing in the last 5-6 years, and then kind of increase the capacity across India. I think lastly, a simple task that every one of you can probably do is spread the positive message about bats. I think we need every possible support we can get to kind of mitigate the negative perception that has been media has created about bats now. So we have circulated a couple of press releases so far. About 64 characters from across 6 Southeast Asian countries have joined together and published a press release. We are happy to share that with you. We can circulate that, read it, circulate among your circle, share it. In fact, this has been published in multiple languages across India, and we are happy to share. We are also working on a couple of illustrations now and small stories, which again can be circulated, and we'll probably have a better messaging from a pictorial perspective. With that, I take a pause and then I can open up for questions. David, over to you.
Thank you so much, Rajesh. It was a wonderful session. I mean, we all enjoyed it. And there's some fantastic pictures, I must say that. Okay, there's some quite a few questions. Do you want me to read out, or do you go through some of the relevant ones? And
yeah, I think I can see this. I'll probably start picking up from top. Okay, I think the first question is how to get upcoming updates. So if you want to know more about Bat Conservation Trust and the project that we're working on, we have a membership field open up form. You can just become a member of Bat Conservation Trust. We will start communicating about new projects or any other field work that we have. And then we can connect and probably you can join one of the projects that we're working on. Similarly, we keep posting on Facebook. You can pick up one of those threads, monitor those threads, and then join us for any of the projects, either short-term or long-term projects. What the next question? Okay, any endangered species in bats? Yes, there are quite a lot of endangered species. For example, one of the most critically endangered is the collar leaf-nosed bat, which as per the latest research report, found only in one cave. Which was actually basically found in two caves, but the recent research concludes that this bat is found only in one cave right now and has gone locally extinct in another cave. So this probably is the one that we are staring at in extinction now. If something is not done to prevent their extermination, then I think probably we'll lose this bat. There are other bat called Hippos Durgadasi, is called Durgadasi leaf-nosed bat, which is also kind of endangered. Earlier, it was known only from one place in near Kajuraho, but now, fortunately, it was also found along with the collar leaf-nosed bat. So the range of their occurrence is quite large now, because of which the classification been brought down, and there are more chance of this bat surviving for a longer run than the collar leaf-nosed bat. There are other bats as well, which are vulnerable. We'll probably need to look into the distribution. Some of the has been classified as vulnerable because we don't have much data in terms of their distribution. So only if there's enough research carried out, we'll know whether there's widespread or they still stick to only certain roost locations. Okay, what's the function of this strange leaf-shaped nose? So I don't know whether I can really answer this 100% accurately, but it's said that all the face structures, the leaf nose or the cella or the whatever the facial characters, they all help in the echolocation and then kind of receive the echolocation calls back through the ears as well as the senses. So I think probably that's one of the core reason I would say. Does it do anything else? We're really not sure. I think not much study has been carried out about the nose leaf structure as such. But whatever basic research has happened and has been published, as per my understanding is concerned, I think they do help to some extent with respect to echolocation aspects of it. Next question is, since you refer to signature calls for different species, have the calls been used to review the taxonomy of bats? Absolutely. There are various papers which have now reclassifying some bat species either as a subspecies or a race based on the variation in the echolocation calls. Whereas from a morphology perspective, they might have a lot of similarity, but based on the calls, there could have been difference. One simple example is called Rhinophus ruxi. It's called Rufus horseshoe bat. Normally, these bats have a frequency of 80 kilohertz, whereas there's one more ruxi which has slightly larger in size and has a frequency somewhere around 90 kilohertz. So these have been subclassified by Dr. Balaji Chattopadhyay and team, and I think Dr. Sripathi worked together in the past, and then they call it as Indo-ruxi, Rhinophus Indo-ruxi. Of course, this I don't think this has been widely accepted so far. So more work needs to be done from a probably a DNA mapping perspective. So probably that will give us more insight into how you classify species. I think just based on frequency, it might be difficult to classify as a separate species. But I think we are probably evolving and need to look at DNA perspective as well. Next question, do vampires really suck human blood? Okay, so first of all, I would like to clarify, there's no vampire bats in India. The vampire bats are found only in Mexico and certain Latin American countries. And these bats primarily feed on wild animals or cattle and not necessarily mummies. There are few incidences or reports of these bats feeding on humans when they are asleep, but I don't think they've caused any harm. So these vampire bats have an anticoagulant in their saliva, which they first apply and then basically works just like any other leech. So you won't really feel when they're biting, and it does not cause any damage to the human beings or to the animal that they're feeding on. Okay, next question. Why haven't we done any sound recording in India so far, even though we have so many species diversity than some other European countries? Okay, great question. First of all, in India, we don't have so many people working or studying bats. I think we have a handful of people studying on bats, and there's not been enough attention given to these aspects. But I think in the last 5-10 years, I think there are a lot of researchers who have given some focus on echolocation and ultrasound perspective as well. So there is some database, but unfortunately, these data are lying in the respective universities or respective researchers have not really been combined into one database. So there are discussions going on among all the cryptologists. We are probably, we'll probably have some common library in a couple of years, if not months, maybe in 1 or 2 years down the line. We see a lot of proactiveness in people sharing the data right now. And I think it's high time we should have a common library, which is contributed by collectively by all the researchers. Okay, there's one more question which says, which are the locations sanctuaries protected in Karnataka based on presence of bats? That's a good question. So I think across India, I'm not sure about South Asia, but I think across India, Karnataka is the only state which has two areas declared as a protected area because of bats. The first one was the Bhimgad Wildlife Sanctuary. which was declared as a protected, it was initially declared as a conservation reserve, later as a wildlife sanctuary, mainly for the presence of rotten straight-tailed bat. And most recent is the Kolar leaf-nosed bat, which is the Hanumanli Conservation Reserve. Again, it's a very newly, maybe less than a year, I think. It's been notified less than a year as a conservation reserve. So a lot more work has to be done on that. Okay, I think repeat questions. How bats do their nesting and lay eggs? Okay. So first and foremost, bats are not birds. Bats are mammals. They don't lay eggs. They give birth to live beings, and just like any other mammals, they do give birth, and the babies normally cling on to the mother when they are given birth. Okay. Bats are mammals, not birds. Yeah, okay. I think someone already answered. I think there's one question, vampire bat. I think we already answered it. Is any bat migratory? Okay, Shailesh, I think this is a really good question. There are no research carried out in India which talk about any of these migrations so far. But in fact, in my own observation in the last 10 years, I have seen the variation of these bats in the cave roots that we've been studying. So these bats do migrate, but where do they migrate, how far they migrate, what for they migrate, is the question still unanswered. But we know the fact that some of these bats are found in certain caves or certain roosts in a certain part of the year, but not found in certain other part of the year. Whether they migrate for food, or they migrate for temperature, whether they migrate for breeding, that is still unknown. But what I've noticed is the Rosettes lacerati, which is a fulvous fruit bat, congregates more in a cave environment during peak summer and monsoon, and that's the time when I've seen them giving birth and having pups. So some of these bats migrate or what do you call pick up cave environment as a roost location, because it kind of gives them a right safe place for them to roost and then take care of the nursing aspect of the pups. And they all breed at the same time, so it kind of works in same fashion as what of birds which migrate for breeding. So Surya has, how important is collaboration within single bat species? Does it depend on age or sex, or is it random? Okay, so this is again interesting question. The initial research papers believed that some of these bats turn more rufous in color or more orangish and rufous in color during breeding season or when they're in the prime. But I think in the recent research has said the otherwise. There's no guarantee or not, there's no deciding factor which affects the coloration of the individual. Or probably there's not evidence now to say, because I myself have seen, for example, Hipposcus purus, Nidus leaf-nosed bat, or other horseshoe bats or leaf-nosed bats, change in color in different parts of the year. There are colonies where almost about 100 bats could be grayish brown in color, but one or two would be kind of rufous in color, and other could be common. Whereas in some time during monsoon, I've seen most of them have great color, so they kind of change the color. So in short, there's no evidence as such. I think more work needs to be done. Probably if you start looking at the hormonal aspect of it and other biological aspect, we'll have more insight into it. Is there any parental calls in bats? Like, do the young have a distinct call to connect with the parent and vice versa? Yes, it's known that just like any other bird chicks, bats can also recognize their parents as well as the parents can recognize the young ones. Especially the lesser most-tailed bat, have seen them have a separate nursery colony where the young ones stay separately. And when the parents come back, the mothers always go back to their own young one together and then join back. So they do can recognize their calls distinctly. Okay, I think the next is, I heard that there are some vampire bats that can share blood. Can you please explain about this change? I've read this about recently, but I'm not really an authority to kind of answer that question. Possible, but unfortunately I can't answer that, sorry. How come the incubation period of the rabies virus is longer in bats as compared to other mammals? Will they show symptoms of the disease? I'm not sure if I have the answer to this, but bats do harbor virus. And again, most of these viruses can survive in the bat for a longer period. And they don't show symptoms because they have antibodies in their body. And only when the antibodies are weak or probably they get infected, then they should start showing symptoms. But the moment they are infected, I think there's very rare chances of that infected bats to survive and then transmit to human beings. So bats transmitting either rabies or any other virus is, I think, is very rare circumstance unless through a secondary host where the virus evolves. Okay. Next is there intermediate is required for spread of virus from bats? It was said that Nipah virus was originated from fruits which was chewed by bats carrying those virus. Is it true? In a stress or reproductive time, do the bat do the produce saliva more? Yes, in most circumstances, an intermediate host is required because most of these viruses cannot directly affect human beings. So they need to kind of evolve or need an intermediary host to kind of evolve and transmit into human beings. Of course, with respect to Nipah, I think there is direct evidence where these virus spread either through urine or through the saliva when the bats went to feed on the the palm secretion. Sorry, I'm not able to get the terminology. I think that's when probably kind of spread to the human beings. And so I think other instance was, with, especially with respect to Kerala, was the fruit, half-eaten fruit by the bat was consumed by humans. And then that's how the virus spread. Yes, it is possible in certain instances, but in most of the situations, it needs a secondary host to transmit.
Rajesh, sorry to butt in between. There are a lot of questions are piling up. Probably choose five more questions. Then you can put your email ID and your website name so they can contact you. Choose five questions and we can finish it.
Okay. So I'm just putting this last slide. I think this, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So everyone can take down my email and then share these questions. Sorry, now I can't see the chat. Can you just read those?
Oh, do you want me to read out?
Yeah, because I can't see the chat window now.
Oh, okay. There's a question from Deepthi Bajaj. Do any of bats in India show hibernation?
Okay, good question. So I think there is some kind of hibernation in Himalayas, but I'm not too sure. Maybe I can probably get back to you on that. But in South, we're not seeing any hibernation. We are seeing some bats go into kind of what we call as a torpor mode. It's more like a semi-hibernation, I would say. But yeah, if disturbed, probably they do take off. But yes, they do get into torpor mode.
Okay, thank you. There is a question from Shashwat Desa. Is there any assessment done on impact of air and light pollution, especially in the cities, on the bat population?
Not in India so far. There is, I think, a recent paper published in Europe which talks about light pollution affecting bats. And there are places where people are moving from warm light to LED light and the red lights as well to kind of reduce the impact. But if you look at a lot of light posts, those attract insects, and obviously those insects attract the bats. Yes, some species might get affected, but some species do adapt.
Okay, I'm just struggling to get up good questions. Do caterpillars form part of their diet? Do they eat caterpillars?
Yes, caterpillars do form the diet. In fact, a lot of caterpillars which affect commercial crops like maize, or even orange, pomegranate. So bats act as predators for these caterpillars and then help in preventing further damage to the crops. Yes, they do.
Okay, one question from Charlie Thomas. I think that's the last one we can take. Sir, could you please tell us some conservation measures we can implement in Kerala or any other states, like the conservation, their roosting sites, and all, like any type of policies should be implemented by the government for their conservation?
Unfortunately, there have not been any other instance other than Karnataka where such initiative has been taken. I think it's very important for regional stakeholders also to kind of spearhead the movement. And then obviously there are a lot of organizations along with Bad Conservation Trust who can really support those initiatives. What needs to be kept in mind is there has to be some unique aspect or important aspect that we can probably build on. So obviously we can help you out, drive those aspects. We can share the scientific data and also the way that we can position. So a lot of this policy aspect, in my own experience, it depends on how we position to the government. Not everyone will be ready to listen and then agree to declare a particular area as a protected area unless they bring in the real value to it. So in fact, Karnataka government has declared a few other areas under protection. Of course, they're not declared officially yet, but we have been successful in bringing those areas into the attention of the Forest Department, where hitherto it was completely neglected. Now there are the forest guards who go for a beat every day in the morning and evening, and then kind of ensure those area and those cave roosts are protected and no further hunting is happening in that area. So you don't need to declare or get a specific area is declared as a conservation reserve or a sanctuary. You can still get those particular caves or roost production without an officially naming it.
Okay. Thank you so much, Sir. I mean, it's a pleasure to hear from you. I mean, those who have any more questions, please write to Rajesh, and there's a number also that you can contact him. He's a busy person, but still I'm sure he'll get back to you.
And thanks, everyone. David, if you can just share all these questions to me with the names of those people and contact details if you have, I can probably slowly start replying to them.
I don't know how to save this. Let me try to figure it out, sir. And sure, also, sure. I'm just calling up Surya Ramachandran to just say a word of thanks. You know, I think, is he there, Surya?
Yeah, David, thanks for this. Rajesh, can all of you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Rajesh, thank you so much for this. I've been, all of us have been waiting for a good session on bats because we are all exposed to other things during our time in the field. But bats is something which I personally was interested in, and I've spoken to you also on the phone a couple of times. Yes. But I don't think anyone has been so open to those questions or helping us out over time. And it's so good to hear you and share this session with you. And all of the others who are listening to this session, you're lucky to hear from Rajesh. Please do take his details. Like David said, he's a busy person, but he's one of those few experts who is willing to share their time and experience with novices like us and help us get into the cause and learn more so that we can be contributors for the future. Rajesh, again, thank you so much for all the help you've done for us during the time we were writing our book. And I'm sure I will be getting in touch with you for the future. And I'm sure all of the others will also be getting in touch with you to help out with bat conservation in India. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thanks, David. Thanks, Surya, for organizing this and giving us an opportunity. I think it's very important that we all work collectively and then share our knowledge, whatever we have, for the good of bats. And I look forward for interacting with more people. So please, everyone, thanks for joining in and taking your time out on the weekend from your family and then joining this session. So you have my details. If you have still not taken down the details from this presentation, just search for batsconservationindia.org. My information is on the website, and I'm available on Facebook as well. So please ping me. I'm happy to kind of share any response when I can. Okay, so I might take some time as informal, but I'll definitely get back to you and happy to share my information. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I mean, yeah. Once again, we'll have more session tomorrow onwards. Please do join us and stay safe. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye-bye. Good night.